benign neutrality is not, you know, is different than that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And everybody is familiar with the first kind that we have discussed, are we not? Yeah. Everybody is familiar with it. When the going gets tough, the tough get going. That is the first kind of vairagya. So you just abandon everything because it is hard to do. And then it gets even more dangerous because after a smattering of Vedanta, it's very difficult to distinguish it from the other vairagya that we haven't yet talked about. So, from the real vairagya, it gets difficult to distinguish because, you know, one starts to feel that, okay, here is the, you know, you study kaupina panchakam, yati panchakam, kaupina vantah khalu bhagyavantah, the person of the loincloth. Not that you have to go shopping for a loincloth, meaning the person who has only loincloth, not in addition to 10 other wardrobes full of things, also has loincloth. The one who is, you know, completely at the behest of the elements, the one who is, you know, given up things, is the most fortunate one and is the person of knowledge. And when we hear, when people hear things like this, what happens? One starts to, this kind of jihasa vairagya dangerously rides on that other vairagya and thinks there is some kind of an overlay, and then one starts to think that this inaction and this, you know, this hopelessness is really the key to gaining moksha. It is not, you know, this is not how one gains moksha. So that is why these two kinds of vairagyas have to be separated. You know, when Adi Shankara says vairagya di lakshana, we cannot just gloss over it. It has to be totally separated. So the first one is called jihasa vairagya. Yeah, that is what is called Shmashana Vairagya also. Meaning, Shmashana means funeral ground. And so somebody dies. I mean, we hear things like this, that Malaysian flight, it's gone. I mean, nobody has any wreckage, nobody knows where it is, everybody is a wreck. Nobody knows where it is. And now, more recently, that ship with all the children, you know, sunk. And then this is called funeral ground vairagya, is that when you go to, when you encounter such situations, you start questioning the value of life. You start questioning your own quality of life. You start making, you know, reassessments of what is important, you know. And you start thinking that what I have been doing is so wrong, and I should really be very much into, you know, into giving all this up because this is not going to help me. There is an element of truth to it. But then more often than not, the hopelessness overrides that, overcomes that truth, overwhelms that truth. And then one gives into that hopelessness. That's why it's very important to separate the two. And in fact, the hopeless vairagya is what is everyone's capital. One starts with that hopeless vairagya, nothing works, therefore one comes to Vedanta and, you know, hopes that it will work. But that hopelessness, you know, carries over into Vedanta as well. And so therefore, even if one has jihasa vairagya in the beginning, one has that funeral ground vairagya, what is the use, etc., etc. That's why I said it resets itself at meal times, because eventually one becomes hungry and then the vairagya drops, you know, as the food goes into the stomach, and then after meal, you know, vairagya starts again. So it's a come and go vairagya. But even that, under the hands of a good teacher, can be converted into the the other kind. And what is key is karma yoga. You don't stop doing. You keep doing things, but you do it with an attitude of bhakti and seva. That is what you keep doing. You know, you can't just sort of say, you know, I have this knowledge, so what? I don't have to do anything. Yeah, because that is dangerous.
Uh-huh.
It puts one in a place of, it's in a worst place. In fact, it's worse. Even before you had the knowledge, you feel like you are better off. This is what sometimes people have told me, that actually before this knowledge I was active, I was doing my things. Yes, they were meaningless things, but at least I was engaged in doing them. But now I am ubhaya bhrashta. Means what? Ubhaya means both, neither here nor there. Like I told a story of the dog, of the dhobi in Atlanta. You know, neither here nor there. So you cannot be like that. So vairagyadi lakshana. Is this, what is meant by vairagya? First we have to know. It's a place of outgrowing things that have become, you know, difficult. Outgrowing this. And this outgrowing has to happen. And I think the class has already started. Anyhow, we'll just continue. Yeah, so we outgrow the situation. We outgrow the need. And the outgrowing cannot be enforced, although it can be encouraged. So, if we are too quick, if one is too quick to drop everything in a hurry, then those things will bite back, come back with a big vengeance and take a bite out of you. So therefore, you outgrow, you allow the knowledge and the desire for the knowledge to overpower the senses, to overpower the being, and the desire for the freedom to overpower you, so that all the other things that exert power become powerless. That is the way to go. This is what the Gita, Bhagavad Gita recommends. Rasavarjam rasopyasya param drishtva nivartate. Param drishtva. So you make param, para, para vidya here, same thing. You make that the ultimate goal, and then you know what happens? That even without when you make that the goal, even though the other things exercise certain force, they recede to the background. Because this is how one has lived. Because in Adi Shankara's Kshamapana Stotra, he says that I was addicted to mother's milk, I was addicted to the breast, you know. And he just says that, you know, this was a craving. I could not be, if my mouth was separated from the mother's breast, I cried helplessly because that was my security. Then as one grows older, then you have that, what is that?
Pacifier,
you know, keep on sucking something. And then little more older, security blanket. Without that blanket, nowhere the, you know, something that has the smell of the mother, the father. So that one it takes, security blanket, pillow, teddy bear, something. Then you graduate to doll, and from doll to mall. That happens very quickly. And then, you know, this is how one, you know, keeps outgrowing the previous addiction to get to the new addiction. But if that addiction happens to be something other than you, then you will never get it. And even getting it, you will never be satisfied. But if that addiction is turned back on to you, that is the source of all satisfaction, because that addiction is not really an addiction, because you cannot be addicted to something you already have. You can only be addicted to things that you do not have and are yet to gain. That's the longing and the craving. When the longing is redirected, that's what we talk about, the U-turn. When the longing is redirected to where it really belongs, is back to you, you know. So finger points back to you. The focus is on you. The spotlight is on you. The place of inquiry is on you. And then so what happens? That all the other things which you are holding on to drop slowly. And this is the benign neutrality. Is that when I'm focused on this knowledge, this vairagya, which makes me give up all kinds of comforts, all kinds of situations and all kinds of attitude which makes me bite back and remain within my certain, you know, remain within the limits of my, you know, basic activity and the pursuit of the knowledge, which keeps me in the pursuit of the knowledge, is called Vairagya. That is the real Vairagya, not Shmashana Vairagya, not Jihasa Vairagya. In fact, that's why it is so difficult to distinguish the two, because one overlays the other. And in fact, it's the first kind of Vairagya that brings one to the knowledge and then spins one into confusion. If I am everything, why do I need to do anything? And then if I'm not doing anything, I get depressed. And so what do I do? This is not Akartritvam. Akartritvam is in the notion that I am free of doership. Being free of doership leaves you free to do anything and everything. And that freedom is Vairagya here, described as a qualification prior to gaining the knowledge. Although sometimes, especially in the modern Kali Yuga, it is the knowledge is gained, you know, in addition to the qualifications at the same time, right? So therefore, this is what is called as Vairagya. So this Vairagya becomes important. Because, and why does he mention Vairagya? I said for two reasons. So first we saw two kinds of Vairagya. Now we will see the two reasons described by Adi Shankara for this Vairagya. And what are the two reasons? The first reason is because Vairagya is the key to gaining this knowledge. It is the key. But what about Shraddha? In Bhagavad Gita, Shraddhavan Labhate Jnanam. Yeah. And even here he says, Shraddha Bhakti Purasaras Santaha. You know, in the beginning, in the Upodghata Bhashya, in the introductory Bhashya, he already says this. Shraddha Bhakti Purasaraha means those who have Shraddha and those who have Bhakti are the ones to gain this knowledge. They are the ones pursuing this knowledge. He says that. Even in this thing. And then Gita says, the one who has Shraddha gains the knowledge. But here he says, Vairagyadi Lakshanaha. Vairagya he mentions. What is the difference between Shraddha and Vairagya? You know, both are attitudinal. Shraddha is an attitude of reverence, correct? And then Vairagya is the attitude of dropping the longings. In both there is an attitude, there is rather a non-doing rather than a doing. So what is the difference? In fact, you know, generally Shraddha comes before Vairagya. It is the Shraddha, it is the faith that I can be redeemed. It is the faith that there is some hope here. And it is the faith that, you know, that this teaching will help me to see the truth of myself is what frequently makes me approach the knowledge. But then along with the approach, if Vairagya doesn't approach, then the knowledge is at best a reproach. It doesn't turn into anything. So Shraddha is mentioned by the Bhagavad Gita because it sees the basic thing needed, which is of course really, and Shraddha brings in Vairagya really. And Shraddha has already been discussed earlier by Adi Shankara, and I'll point exactly where in the introductory Bhashya. So you can start looking at the lack of contradiction here and how each part speaks to the other part. And somewhere he says, Uttaratra Vakshati Sadaraha Prarochitayam Hi Vidyayam Sadaraha. See, first place at the end of the first paragraph, Sadaraha. That Adara is Shraddha here. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sadaraha Pravarteran Iti. That's why this one is being, Vidya is being praised. And then in another place, just before the, just in the middle of the last paragraph, before the first verse, he says, Shraddha Bhakti Purasaraha Santaha Tesham. Garbha Janma Jara Rogadi Anartha Pugam Nishatayati. So for those people who have Shraddha Bhakti in front, Shraddha Bhakti walks in front and they follow. For such people, the fear, grief and samsara are downed with this knowledge, right? He has said that already. So now he brings in Vairagya because he doesn't repeat himself. He's already said what is needed. But the thing that Shraddha drags in for free is Vairagya. Yeah. Shraddha brings in Vairagya. Shraddha means I have an open mind for this knowledge. I have the attitude of reverence for the teacher and the teaching. That is Shraddha. And then Bhakti is also the same thing. So then, because of that attitude, that I have the reverence for this teaching, I value this teaching, therefore I drop other pursuits which are meaningless from my life. You see that? That's what this whole thing is. That's the connection. The more important and the second reason he mentions this is because of that key verse for which this Upanishad has become famous. What is that key verse, key mantra? Parikshalokan karmachitan nirvedamayat brahmanah nastyakritah kritena tad vijnanartham guru meva abhigachet. So here when he says guru abhigamanam, he uses the same words as that mantra. And I'll explain what that is shortly. And in using the same word, what is there? Parikshalokan karmachitan. Seeing this world of finite means an ends. Nirvedam ayat brahmanaha. The person of discrimination gains vairagya. Nirveda here is vairagya. Gains vairagya by seeing that everything is finite and what I am seeking is para, infinite. And so that which makes it para is what? My attitude with which I pursue this knowledge, because I want the infinite. And seeking the infinite, I approach the teacher because the infinite being myself is not discernible to me as an object. So therefore, to unravel the nature of the subject, to reveal the nature of the subject, I seek the help of the Upanishad handled by a teacher. So you see, that is Vairagya. And Vairagya proceeds from Shraddha alone. And so therefore, that Samit Panihi comes, Shraddha comes there. And so here he is remembering the verse. The only verse, the main verse, I mean, this Upanishad is known for everything, but it is known for Vairagya in that mantra and also by its name Mundaka. What does Mundaka mean? Head shaving ceremony. And when do you shave the head? Yeah. You know, before, during or after studying the Upanishad? Before studying the Upanishad, you shave the head and you carry a bag of coals on the live, you know, head. Yeah. And then you place it at the feet of the teacher after making three perambulations of the ashram. This is what is called Shirovratam. You know, and if the brain has not still melted at this point, the teacher will teach. This is the idea. So one carrying live coals on the head, they are not going to stop for coffee and stop to go to the outlet mall and, you know, and seek any other outlet. They are not going to do that. They're going to run because the head is on fire. And the head being on fire signifies the burning desire for knowledge. And the one who has a burning desire for knowledge will have Vairagya. Like if the house is on fire, you will have Vairagya for all the possessions. You will run out, correct? Yeah. Yeah, just like that. You know, plane makes emergency landing and they will say, they need not even say, leave your carry-ons, you first get out. They don't even have to say. Nobody is going to look for their carry-ons. Sometimes the carry-ons weigh greater than the person. And so you can't, you know, you are just interested in saving yourself and your children and your loved ones. Those who you are going on these kinds of, dangerous trips with. And so, you just want to get out of that situation. So, if the house is on fire, you are not trying to save, you know, some leftover that you have kept in the fridge. You are not saying that, oh, I want that, what will I eat when I come out? You just run, correct? Yeah, so when the head is on fire, head means the place of cognition. That's why head, you know. So when that cognitive, you know, function where all my cognitions of the object, of various discrete objects, have led me to more and more finite situations, and that is not fine with me. I want the infinite. So when that problem has arisen that I don't know the infinite, I really need to understand that which is infinite as myself, then what happens? That is when the Vairagya sets in. And so this Mundakopanishad stands for Vairagya. Not that other Upanishads don't, but this is a highlight of it. Like Viveka Chudamani, what is the highlight? Ayo, Devre, what is the highlight of Viveka Chudamani? Okay, let me illustrate it in another way. You know, when I was small, there used to be these street performers that used to come, correct? And we would all run out and go and see them. And to me, who was 3 or 4, this was like magic. One fellow was blindfolded and put in the center of the circle. We were all around the circle. And we were all clapping and jumping. And there was some chorus, some song they used to sing each month they came. And then, so one fellow was sitting in the chair blindfolded. And another, and that was a know-it-all, sitting in the chair. And then he had a sidekick who would say, and sometimes they would pick out children from the ring. And then that a little girl in the yellow frock with pigtails, you know, the one that is standing right here, the one in this side of the circle, and then isn't it a nice day, ladies and gentlemen and children? Yes, yes, it's a wonderful day. So what is that girl wearing? And the blindfolded man would say, yellow. Oh, how did he know this? That girl with the green dress and the pink bow in her hair. And you know, yesterday something happened and some little distraction would be there. And then after that, so, what is the color of the bows in her hair? And the blindfolded man, without batting an eyelid, would say, pink. And we would say, oh my God, how does he know this? You know that red truck that just passed by? Oh, it was carrying all kinds of things. Did you see? It was carrying iron rods. It was carrying pieces of big, long pieces of wood. And then it had a little, you know, flag that said danger and all these things. It was going somewhere. What was the color of the truck? Can you please tell? Red. Oh my God. So I feel like I'm playing this game, yes, with you. When I say, what is the highlight of Viveka Chudamani? Habba. Yeah. So that is what it is. So every Upanishad is highlighting something here. And so for Mundaka it is Vairagya. So Adi Shankara in his own way zeroes in on this Vairagya. And he says, Guru, Guru Abhigamanam, first Lakshana, and second Lakshana, Vairagya Purvakam Abhigamanam, you know, Yasya, for that person, for whom the approach is full of Vairagya, is filled with dispassion for all other things in the here and the hereafter. The dispassion does not translate into laziness. The dispassion does not translate into hopelessness. The dispassion does not translate into inaction. Yeah, that's what we have to see. And so he says, Guru Vairagyadi Lakshana Adhigamaha Sambhavati Iti Prithakkaranam Brahma Vidyayaha Para Vidya Iti Kathanam Cha Iti. So therefore, this distinction is valid. What distinction? Let us make sure we are on the same page. Literally. What is the distinction that is valid? Quick. Para and Apara. Thank you. Alright. So the distinction is valid. And why is this distinction valid? The distinction is valid because the understanding of the meanings of the words do not convey the knowledge. It requires additional initiative. And the additional initiative is seeking help from a teacher and then being equipped with the proper, you know, accoutrements in terms of preparation to gain this knowledge. Then he says there is actually another reason why this distinction is valid. Let us read it. Yatha.
Yatha.
Vidhi Vishaye.
Vidhi Vishaye.
Kartradi.
Kartradi.
Aneka Karaka.
Aneka Karaka.
Upasamhara Dvarena.
Upasamhara Dvarena.
Vakyartha.
Vakyartha.
Jnana Kalad.
Jnana Kalad.
Anyatra.
Anyatra.
Anushteya. Anushteya.
Anushteya.
Arthosti.
Arthosti.
Agnihotradi Lakshanaha.
Agnihotradi Lakshanaha.
Natatha Iha.
Natatha Iha.
Paravidya Vishaye.
Paravidya Vishaye.
So another big distinction is there between the ultimate and the non-ultimate knowledge. The non-ultimate or the knowledge of the relative ends and means, and the absolute knowledge which talks about the yourself as everything in this universe, there is a big difference. And what is the big difference? He says that in the non-ultimate or the relative knowledge of means and ends, gaining the knowledge of means and ends is not going to give you those ends. You have to deploy the means to get the ends. Like, you know, you have a book of desserts. Yeah, how to make desserts, right? And then you open the page. Oh, you can make stack cookies like this and put some things inside and then put a sauce over it and call it dessert. Oh, what a nice thing. Oh, look at this page, how lovely it looks. So here is this wonderful velvet chocolate cake and all made without egg, without anything, without lard and all vegetarian. And this is looking so good. And then, you know, then you have the reaction of the dog of Pavlov. What did it do? It salivated, yeah, it started to drool. So then, you have the desire that is born for the cake, for the cookie, correct? What do you have to do after reading the recipe to fulfill the desire? You have to run to the market to get those ingredients, correct? And then you have to sift the ingredient, mix the ingredient, let it rise, let it set, whatever it is, and then you put it in the oven. And then you have to let it cool, then you have to frost it, and then you have to cut it, and then you have to serve it, then only you can eat it, right? Mm-hmm. That's a long way off. Either that or you have to tear off the picture in the book which has all the colors and consume it immediately. Yeah. So in this thing there is no instant gratification. This is very amazing. In every pursuit, in all the pursuits except Brahma Vidya, there is no instant gratification. Even though we say instant noodles, instant coffee, instant tea, instant donuts, instant idli, instant dosa, you know, instant everything, instant teeth, you know, dentures, and instant everything. It's non-instant. In fact, even more instant than instant dosas is this knowledge, which happens in an instant because it is not separate from you. So those who are into instant gratification, we have news for you, Adi Shankara says. If you want instant gratification, oh ye, one and all, don't waste your time. Why ye? Because he's old fashioned. Don't waste your time in this non-instant gratification, because even making one cake, you know, you have to go for, you know, you have to go, you have to put so much mahada ayasena, you know, mahata ayasena, you have to do so much ayasa effort, and after that you have to take rest, you know, before making the next cake. And does the first cake satisfy? No, because I sniffed it, you know, I just inhaled it, and so you know, there was nothing there left. So the first cake did not satisfy. Did the second cake satisfy? Well, no, because somebody came and I was forced to be hospitable and serve it to them. So the first cake did not satisfy because it was gone. Second cake did not satisfy because it was gone into somebody else's tummy, because I had to be hospitable. Oh, third cake, there was something wrong. It took me straight to the hospital. And you know, that also did not satisfy. Correct? So this is not instant. And it's neither instant nor it is lasting. Anything other than Brahma Vidya, which is called Apara, is neither instant nor is it lasting. And here we seem to want contradictory things. We want something instantly and it should be forever. How is that possible? But it is possible because it's you. It's already you. You are instantly cognized. Are you here?
Yes.
And then, and you are everlasting. Are you here now?
Yes.
Now?
Yes.
Now?
Yes.
Now?
Yes.
Now? Yes. You are the only thing that is instant and it is everlasting. That's all. So this whole instant gratification is not a wrong thing because it's built into one. This desire to be instantly, understand the nature of oneself is built in. In an instant I want to know. And that knowledge is forever. No other thing in this world can give you this. So even if you come from this, even if you are feeling guilty about instant gratification and saying, oh, I am into instant gratification. See, Adi Shankara is benign enough to give us a way out and feel good about ourselves. Yes, I am into instant gratification forever. And the only thing that is instant and the only thing forever is the self-revealing I. Fantastic. Because nothing is instant. They are all lying in the shop. You go to any supermarket, instant this, instant that, food in a bag and then, that doesn't do anything. All these packet food and packet dinners and packet lunches, It's just a spoof. Nothing is instant except you. Of course, being you, being the nature of you, you instantly get attracted to that which is bandied as instant, that which is billed as instant. Because instant recognizes instant instantly. But then that is where it stops. Because the I which is living in the wrong place takes over and thinks that if I had this, I would be instantly happy forever. But the instant here, the instant within recognizes the instant without, that which is known in an instant. But then what happens is that the rest of it goes down the drain because I think that object, this instant is this own, this thing which is other than me, if I grasp a hold of it, it will fulfill me. It will help me to recognize this. It won't. Because if you are not available in an instant, the non-instant cannot be made instant, correct? Yeah. You cannot take non-instant coffee and make it instant. It has to go through another process. Yeah. So the instant cannot be made into non-instant, right? So if you are the only thing that is instant and everything else is non-instant, you cannot become non-instant. And that which is non-instant cannot become instant. So that is why the distinction between para and apara. And here apara means non-instant, para means instantly available as I. Atma anubhuti swarupaha, upalabdhi swarupaha means that which is immediately available, aham, 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 I. But then the instant which is outside of you, which is being called known as idam, this idam is not aham. Yeah. This idam resolves into aham, is born out of aham, but then it is not the same. Aham is the one upholding the idam, Idam is aham, aham is not idam. Yeah. Idam means this. That which is the product of this cognition comes under apara vidya. That which is the product of I cognition, which is instantly recognized as I, which is that, and what is instantly recognized? I am the only thing that is forever. That is the knowledge. That cognition comes under para vidya. So the cognition, the two cognitions are separate because the one is a product of what? Karma, doing. You know, to make instant coffee, how much work is gone? Non-instant work is needed to produce this so-called instant coffee, instant teeth, instant this, instant that. Such, it is so much, in fact, that's what is called processed. So much process is needed. Processed food, the more instant it is, the more processed it is. So the process means what? It has to go through many more factories. That's why it's more expensive than making it, as they say, from scratch. Yeah. Here, this Atma is always in the form of experience. Are you experiencing yourself?
Yes.
Do you need to pinch to find out if you're experiencing yourself? Do you need to say, ow, before you say, I am experiencing myself? No. Because you are experiencing yourself, you say, ow, correct? Yeah. Piercing culture notwithstanding. And so, that which is always in the form of experience doesn't need to be experienced as a thought, as an object, as anything separately from itself. It is available always and it is always known as the subject which is ever experienced. The nature of this subject, that it is forever, that Vidya that gives this teaching is called Para. Everything else is Apara. So this instant and forever. You cannot have at the same time? Yes, you can. Only when it is centered on the I. This I is the only place where instant and forever coexist happily as one. Instant, Sat Chit, forever, Ananda. Yes. So this is what it is. Instant, existent, you know, instantly existent, forever. So he says that's why this distinction is valid. Because in the other Vidya, if you just, you know, buy the instant noodles, you can't do anything. You have to, you are in soup. You have to then heat the water, even instant noodle, then you have to put the bag into the hot water. Correct? Some effort is needed. Yeah, or you eat it as it is, you know. And little crunchy, but I'm sure it's harmless. And then either you eat it as it is or you have to do something to it. But para knowledge is instant, instantaneously, because it is touching upon that which is already existent, without whose existence doesn't have to be validated, doesn't have to be, you know, ratified, doesn't have to be pointed to by some other cognition. That cognition which advertises my existence, that same cognition, on that same cognition, rides the wave of forever, that your existence is without a second. Your existence is unmarred. Your existence is not in any way sullied or afflicted by papa, punya, time, space, etc. Your existence is free of guilt and hurt. Your existence is the only thing that exists forever. This is what is the basis for the distinction, because there is no other thing needing to be done. And so, let us look at the words in the Bhashya. Very beautiful. And here, yatha vidhi vishaye, just as vidhi vishaye, in the matters of doing, in the matters of things being enjoined by the Vedas, kartradi aneka karaka upasamhara dwarena. So through the outlet of various karakas. Karakas means factors involved in action. Yeah. Factors involved in action, karaka. Like karta, doer, done, you know, object, subject, instrument, etc. Kartradi aneka karaka upasamhara dwarena vakyartha jnana kalat, you know. So through the deployment of the doer, instrument of doing, and the object and the subject and the instrument to to make it very simple, at least three factors are involved. So you take instant noodles, you have the subject. Who is the subject? Don't say I am a noodle. No, you know, I am the subject other than the noodle. Noodle is the object. And then you need the pot of boiling water instrument, correct? So through these things, this Kriya Nishpatti takes place. What is Kriya Nishpatti? The noodles are brought to life to be made into an edible source. And what is the problem that took me to the noodles? Hunger. So to assuage the hunger, these three factors are what are involved in creating the action that brings the noodle to a state of being a consumable product by me, so that the hunger is assuaged, right? So then this is what is called Kriya Nishpattihi, means the accomplishment of the action based on what is that? Kartradi Aneka Kartra, Karta, etc. Means Karta, Karma, Karana, three only we have taken. And then if you are making the noodles for someone else, Sampradana also is there for the sake of, you know, noodles, for the sake of this person, etc. So all the factors involved in action, like subject, object, and then boiling pot of water, instrument, and for maybe you are making the noodles for your child, the child for whose sake the noodles are being prepared, these are called Karaka. Karaka Upasamhara Dwarena means through the outlet which deploys all these Karakas, what happens? Jnana Kalat means from the time that the instant noodle knowledge took place. When did the instant noodle knowledge, when did it take place? At the storefront. You saw it and said, yes, by the time I drive home, it will be 20 minutes, I will be starving, I better buy this right now. Okay? So when you spied the instant noodles, that is the Jnana Kala. And the cognition took place. What is the cognition? Asti. Asti kaschit, asti kinchit. Something is there. What is that? Instant noodleum, you know, there is something called instant noodleum, you know, nama. There is something called instant noodle, is there, asti, something is there. That is the Jnana Kala, means that is the time of cognition. So the time of cognition that, oh my God, this America is wonderful, so many instant things, and today I have discovered a new instant thing, this is called instant noodle, let us say somebody thought. So that is called instant noodle Jnana Kalam, right? Jnana Kalam means time of knowledge. So the time of knowledge that there exists something called instant noodle. And then to the time that I came home, I brought it home from the shop. Because just knowing that there is instant noodle does not satisfy the hunger, correct? I have to purchase it. So that was one action. Then there is already purchaser, purchased, subject, object. Then I drove it home, Karana. So the Vahana becomes a Karana for bringing it home. Then after that I took the pot and then poured water, boiled the water, and then waited for the water to boil. And then of course, being American, I have to read the instruction and then how to cook. How to cook noodles. And then first thing they will say is stay away, stand away from the pot of boiling water, because here people are very careful, it's a litigational society. So then I realized I was too close, and because I was keeping on watching whether it's boiling or not, so I stepped away. And then the next instruction was that, you know, cut the thing carefully, without cutting yourself. And so then I had to cut the packet, and inside the packet there were two things, one was the noodle and the other one was some seasoning to put on it. And plus there was a third packet. What was that? Silicone to keep it dry. And then it had a nice thing on it stamped, do not eat. And then the instruction said, just put the noodles and the big packet. Don't put the small packet, not to be consumed. So all these instructions are given. So I have to read the instructions and I have to follow the instructions, because otherwise also no noodle comes. If I just put it in cold water, what will happen? You know, I'll have to pour cold water on the hunger also, because it's not going to satiate the hunger. And so all these, so Jnana Kala, What is Jnanakala? The moment that the knowledge that this instant world of eatables is available took place, to actually heating the water and actually putting the noodles and waiting for those 2 minutes, those excruciating 2 minutes, all that is a time, correct? There is a time gap between the knowledge that these sadhanas exists. Sadhana means what? The means called the instant noodle exist for the sadhya, the hunger. That the hunger and the sadhana sadhya are joined, like the hunger joins the instant noodles finally after preparation. There is a big time lag. So really speaking, are the instant noodles instant? No. Says Adi Shankara. And he says, so jnana kala, jnana avasane, what happens? Anyatra. Jnanakalad anyatra anushteya arthaha asthiti agnihotradi lakshanaha. So the first portion of the Veda, which is called Apara Vidya, see, this was the exemplified, now we are looking at the example. So the first portion of the Veda, which is called Apara Vidya, is like these instant noodles. Yeah, exactly. So first you have to go to the first you have to know that there is such a thing. Then you have to go buy into them, literally. And then you have to, just the mantras and the incantations don't do anything. They don't decant your desire. And so after the incantations, you have to do yajna. You have to make the bricks at home. And in between the raindrops in Eugene, you dry the bricks somehow by some miracle. And then what? Because the bricks have to be dried outside, you can't put them in an oven. And then so in between the raindrops, with great difficulty, you dry the bricks. You feel dehydrated afterwards. And then what? Then you put the bricks in a square shaped, that is called Vedi, Yajna Kunda. And then in that you have to light the fire, then gobs of ghee. And then you have to put, and then the ghee and the fire and everything. And then that creates apurva. Punya. That creates punya. Apurva, which you don't know. And you don't know whether actually the noodles have been cooked or not in terms of the Veda. You don't know whether you have cooked it at the right temperature, whether you have boiled this, and you don't know, because the fruit of the yajna is held in abeyance to be given here or hereafter. But one thing you know, that from the time you had the jnana, when you were initiated into a particular Vedic ritual, like Agnihotra, to actually performing it, to actually getting the results, there is a avasanam, there is a time period. And just cognizing that if I do Agnihotra, I will gain Swarga, I will go to heaven, is not enough. That's what he says. Two things he is saying actually, by, you know, here. He says, first thing is, the mere knowledge of Aparavidya is not enough. It requires doership. It requires some doing. Even the instant noodles are not so instant that way. And so what to talk of the Vedic rituals, which he is trying to talk about the first portion of the Vedas, they are not instant either. So first of all, he is saying there is a big time gap between the sadhana, the means that I employ, that is the Vedic ritual, and the sadhya, the effect. Like whether I want the effect to be a child, or whether I want it to be some kind of a, you know, peace of mind, some shanti, so many things. So therefore, there is a time lapse. Second thing he is saying is that the mere knowledge of the rituals is not enough. It requires doership. Did you understand both those things?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Yes.
What are they?
Time
and then effort. Both. Because the sadhana is away from the sadhya. The means are away from the end. Here in the latter portion of the Veda, in Paravidya, what is the end? Yourself. What are the means? You. You are the means. You are the ends. And the guru, going to the guru to get knowledge is the means, yes. But then, there when the knowledge is given, immediately, instantly, that knowledge is understood and takes place. So there is an instant satiety, a satiation that is unlike the other place where the satiation is deferred. And not only is the satiation deferred by time, it is also dependent on other factors of action, karakas. Here the satiation is instant and it's not dependent on anything else other than you. You with vairagya, that's all. You the the prepared mind is all that it is asking for. And so very beautifully he says, you know, vakyartha jnana kalat anyatra means other than just knowing that instant noodles exist, I have to do other things, which are what? Agnihotra, etc. So I have to gather the twigs, I have to make the bricks, I have to make the ghee, and then I have to do all those things. Na tatha, repeat.
Na tatha.
Iha. Para vidya vishaye.
Para vidya vishaye.
Vakyartha jnana samakale.
Vakyartha
jnana samakale. Vakyartha jnana.
Vakyartha jnana.
Samakale eva.
Samakale eva.
Tu. Paryavasito bhavati.
Paryavasito bhavati.
Yeah. So the quest for the instant noodle is not instant. Yeah, is not instantaneous. And then even when you get the recipe for making instant noodles, or even when you buy the packet, there is a time lag, and also it requires doership. It requires something else to be done in order to manufacture this. Whereas you are already manufactured. You are actually not something that is subject to manufacturing. You are uncreated, you are limitless, you are self-existent. And then what? So there is no manufacturing, you are not a product, so there is no manufacturing involved. Second thing, as soon as you know I am the whole, then what happens? The halfness disappears. There is no half, there is no I am a fragment, I am a spark. You know, this is not there anymore. The ajnanam drops instantaneously. And that's the third reason he puts vairagya there. Provided the vairagya is there, provided the guru is there, he brings in the two main things needed to make this knowledge, you know, to make this knowledge, to highlight this knowledge as instantaneously obtained, provided the prepared mind and the provided the mode of teaching which is prepared and deployed properly is there. In the form of the guru, and the guru is the deployment of the correct way of pramana, and the student is symbolized by vairagya. Provided those two are there, then the knowledge is instantaneous. Gaining vairagya is not doership. In fact, it is dropping everything. It's an attitude, correct? So provided the right attitudes are there, the knowledge is instantaneous. Unlike the first one, you may have lot of Shraddha, you may have Bhakti, but still you have to sit and perform the ritual to gain. You can't say, I have so much Bhakti that without doing the ritual, I will gain the ends. What will you get? A big zero. You will not gain the ends. You have to do it. Here there is no doing. Na tatha iha. Not like this here. Where jnana samakale eva, at the time the knowledge is deployed from the mouth of the guru to the ear of the shishya, what happens? Pariyavasito bhavati. Pariyavasanam means conclusion. Sho is the verb, second conjugation. Yeah. Sho, which becomes so. Why? Because that's how it is so. That is just so. Yeah, there is one adesha pratyayoho, whereas the verbs in the dhatu patha, the sha becomes sa, and then it's repatriated again in as sha in certain other situations, but not here. Pari plus ava plus so. So the so second conjugation becomes sitaha, pari ava sitaha. How does it become sitaha? There is one sutra. Siti am or something like that, so that one applies, you know. And anyhow, so pariyavasito bhavati means it is concluded right here, right now. The pursuit is dropped instantaneously. And what is the pursuit? To stop pursuing things. That's the only pursuit. To stop having useless wants is the pursuit. To be stopped being terrorized and tyrannized by grief and fear. That's the pursuit. So instantly when you are told that you are the one that is the cause of the universe, You are the one that is limitless, unafflicted by sorrow, desire, grief, fear, anger, and any kind of incompletion, incompleteness. Immediately, the knowledge that takes place immediately, that's why it's called para. Because you already know this and you sense this at some level. You sense and desire, that desire for the oneness is what morphs into many desires that have nothing to do with the oneness. But that desire for the oneness is the original desire. And that original desire is fulfilled instantaneously, by which knowledge is called para. That's the only knowledge, because that knowledge sits in the knower. Despite the knower, the knowledge takes place. Sits in the place, you know, of the knower. As, yes, you know, this is the thing. There won't be, yes, I know, but I know that I know. I don't have to say, yes, I am the knower of this knowledge. You know, it connects at a very subtle level to that which, to that broadcasting of the I. You know, we have been talking about these pinging from this aircraft which is under the ocean, supposedly, and they are hearing these pingings which are picking up. And the ping is, ahamasmi, 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 ahamasmi. And the Upanishad, you know, the knowledge in the Upanishad, not the Upanishad itself, not the words, the knowledge of the Upanishad deployed by the Guru is this pinging locator, pinger locator. So there is that resonance which recognizes the ping, and that handshake is what is that is talked about here. So the Guru is speaking to that ahamasmi, not to the sad, bad, you know, mad student. The Guru is going through all the raga, dvesha, the knowership, the doership, and speaking to that ahamasmi that is constantly being broadcast behind the din of I want, I am not enough, I am not this, I am guilty, I am hurty, I am all these things. Correct? So the knowledge is speaking to that which is the basis of all these complaints. The complainer is thinking, I am just a bunch of complaints. But the teacher is delineating that ping, ahamasmi, behind the complaints. And speaking to that ahamasmi, tattvamasi, tattvamasi, and that ahamasmi understands it as aham brahmasmi. That same tattvamasi is understood as aham brahmasmi. And so, and that ahamasmi, which everybody knows I am, what I am is misunderstood. The teacher just cuts through the misunderstanding, speaks to the I am and says what you are, and that is instantly understood. Because nobody wants to be this complaining being. This is the revelation of the Upanishad, and this is why it is worthy of separating it. This knowledge is worthy of being separated from that which takes a lifetime to attain and is lost in an instant, which is karma-based, karta-based, karana-based, all that we don't need. So that which pariyavasanam, for, you know, pariyavasati means it puts an end to the pursuit. This itself is what we have to know. So pariyavasito bhavati, the pursuit itself gets under, that gets completed. And then, kevala, shabda prakashita, arthajnana, matra nishtha vyatirikta, abhavat. Yeah. So how does this take place? He says, kevala means only by kevala shabda prakashita arthajnana matra. So only by understanding of the words, you know, because of the understanding of the words don't convey the knowledge. What conveys the knowledge is how the words are understood. That is what is conveyed by the words, not the words themselves, but that which is conveyed by the words, which is non-separate from you. And then prakashita means that which the words light up. Yeah. And that is what is arthajnana matra, that the meaning of the words which is lit up in the antahkarana, in the buddhi, as a vritti, that itself is abidance in the knowledge. So to abide in the knowledge, you don't need anything else. There is a abhava, means there is no other thing needed to abide in the knowledge other than what is conveyed by the words, what is lit up by the words when you hear them. That is all that is needed. So to abide in the knowledge, you don't have to go home and put the words in hot boiling water and cook them for 2 minutes and then put some masala on them and then assimilate them. You don't have to regurgitate them and eat them like a cow does. It itself is enough. So there is abhava asti. What is there? There is a lack. Lack of what? Lack of any other thing other than the lighting up of the words, which is equal to abidance in the knowledge. There is nothing else needed. Unlike natatha, you know, unlike what? Yatha vidhi vishaye kartra adi aneka karaka upasamharat varena. Whereas in the other pursuit, in the first portion of the Veda, this do worship, etc. is needed. Here there is nothing to do. And people don't understand this. They say, now I have Brahmajnana, what should I do? And there's nothing to do, you know? Yeah. So this is what it is. Tasmat
Param
Vidyam
Savisheshena
Aksharena
Vishinashti
Yattat
Adreshyam
Ityadina. Introducing the next mantra, Adi Shankara says, Tasmat, a very big Tasmat, which includes this whole three pages of discussion, almost 3 pages of discussion here about the distinction between para and apara vidyas, the relative and the absolute knowledge, what is the difference, etc., concluding. So Tasmat means what? Therefore, having delineated very painstakingly the Guru in the Upanishad, what has he delineated? The difference between the non-ultimate and the ultimate, in also the non-instant and the instant knowledge. Because the non-instant knowledge almost always or always begs something to do afterwards to accomplish this knowledge. There is both a time gap and a begging of some other factors of action and the involvement of those factors of action. This knowledge is just based on you, that is the non-acting, knowing being, the only being that is a knowing, conscious being upon whom all these wrong, you know, information about being small, being because, being sad, are all superimposed as it were. So in other words, the knowledge just clarifies and clears away, sweeps away those wrong understandings by conveying to the person in the words that are lit up, just not words, words that are handled by the Guru. You know, the Guru takes the words of the Upanishad and makes them into Christmas lights. Yeah, non-blinking. Yeah. So, and then the Christmas lights, because otherwise the words are not lit up. Handled by the mouth of the teacher, the words are lit up. And when the words are lit up, they convey, because that light matches the light that is you. You are also just a, you know, big light. The truth of aham, aham, that is light. I am, I am, I am, that's the constant, never to be put off, non-blinking light. This knowledge is also in the form of non-blinking light. And so in this knowledge, when the words that are lit up by the pramana, by the means of knowledge lit up by the handling of the teacher, convey and banish the ignorance, and they are all that is one needs to abide in this knowledge, nothing more. Of course, the prepared mind, etc., is the attitude that has to come before, but after this knowledge has gained taken place, nothing is needed. And to convey this, the next one is being talked about, the next mantra is being introduced, and he says, Tasmat, therefore, what param vidyam, this para, what is this paravidyam? Savisheshena aksharena vishinashti. Vishinashti means distinguished. To further distinguish this paravidya and to give it some shape and form, you know, to give it some shape and form. Because this paravidya is very amorphous. It is me, yeah, but which me? The complaining me, the non-complaining me. What is this me? How do I grasp this me? Can I, you know, get in touch with me? Not get in touch with the emotions, but not get in touch with the feelings or the complaints or the ideas. But can I get in touch with me? Who is this me? To delineate this me, Vishinashti, another seventh conjugation verb which we don't, another verb which we don't come across. This is from the seventh conjugation from Shish. There are three Shishes. Don't get confused. One Shish is from the first conjugation in the sense of Himsa, in the sense of injury. Another Shish is from the, I think, the tenth conjugation. Yeah, and that tenth conjugation Shish is Visheshe, that which is left out. Yeah. Sheshayati, Shish. And this is the none of those Shishes. This is another Shish. And this Shish is the seventh conjugation, Rudadigana. And then what does this Shish do? Shish means in the sense of separating. Yeah. Vimarshana. Yeah, like that. So this is that Shish. Okay, don't confuse it with leftover. This is not a leftover Vidya. This is a delineated Vidya. So Vishinashti means it separates, it delineates from the other Vidya. How? By saying the following, by saying that what this Paravidya looks like, you know, and what is this Akshara here? What words can I use to describe this Paravidya? How do I understand this Paravidya? It is showing through these words, which the words Yattat Adreksham. Where does this word come? In the next mantra. Yattat Adreksham, Adreshyam, etc. So through that it is distinguishing. Okay? Understood? That's not a big sentence. It's a small sentence. Yeah. So then having, you know, Tasmat means having defended Paravidya is something other than Apara. So this now Paravidya is further going to be delineated by the words Adreshyam, etc. That's the translation. Understood? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Vakshyamanam Buddhau Samhritya Siddhavat Param Rishyate Yattatiti. Yeah. Vakshyamanam means that which is going to be presented. You know, that which is going to be presented. Vakshyamanam, that which is going to be presented. And then Buddhau means in the buddhi, samhritya means having assimilated, siddhavat, what is being assimilated is what? Siddhavastu vishaya. So what is being assimilated is not something to be gained, which is already gained. So that which is going to be told is about that self which is already gained, not something to be gained outside of myself. Through the words yattat, etc., it is going to be told vakshamanam siddhavastu vishaya eva, siddhavastu vishaya eva, paramrishyate, again, is being determined by separating it, is being talked about, is going to be talked about. Okay? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yattat Adreshyam Agrahyam Agotram Avarnam Achakshushrotram Tadapanipadam Nityam Vibhum Sarvagatam Susukshmam Tadavhyayam Bhutayonim Paripashyanti Dhiraha. Yeah, this is supposedly the description of what Paravidya is. It's more of a non-description. You know, we'll see tomorrow. Very beautiful, very nice. So this is, I think now we have progressed from the lineage to the question, to the knowledge that was questioned, and then now we are on, now this has taken a certain track which is going to be very interesting. This first portion of the Mundaka not to be missed, really. Yeah. Please tell everybody to log on, because this is just going to unfold very beautifully. Yeah. So before I go away again on various travels, we have this half of next month. So please log on and, don't miss it. Yeah, I'm happy to see so many people keep the strength of the numbers and keep the strength to come, keep attending the class, because the constant exposure is that which takes away the ajnana. Okay? Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate
Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.
Yeah, I can take a few questions. Yeah, that's what. No, that was because of the guilt. Yeah, total helplessness and guilt. Would it be unconscious? What is unconscious? Didn't understand. You write again, because that context was gone. Yeah, it is from the unconscious only. Vairagya out of despair, the desperation is a product of the unconscious, so definitely, absolutely correct. Other questions? Yes.
I want to ask more about so there is one, and there's oneness, and tree knows the oneness of the other tree or everything around it, but we don't.
Nobody knows the oneness. The tree doesn't need to know, because it's not having a separate will other than being programmed by the universe, by nature. The tree does not keep some of the fruits for itself and then says that, I've given enough. It gives everything. It is programmed to give. The animal is programmed to be territorial, to recognize other species for the continuation of the species. It is not also in violation of the laws of nature. The only person who is in violation of the laws of the nature is the human being, because of the free will. And that same will leads one to judge oneself, and judge oneself as lacking. Yeah. And that lack is made lackluster by this knowledge. That is why this knowledge. Because that lack cannot be inferred as non-lacking. You cannot infer the non-lack. You cannot see it as an object, because you are not an object. So this lack is centered on the subject, and that's where it has to be dispelled, and it is a cognitive dispelling. Yeah, not an act, not based on action. Because it's a cognitive problem. Yeah. Leads me to other action, but the problem, the basis is cognitive. And so that's where I have to dispel it. Good question. Yeah, even the animal may not know all this is one, but it doesn't come to grief. Yeah, because it doesn't have at the most it will bury one bone, the dog. It will not say, I want to bury enough bones for 7 generations. And even after it buries, it forgets. That's why it digs up the entire yard, because it doesn't remember where it has buried. Yeah. So this is what it is. Whereas the human being says, Leo Tolstoy story is very beautiful. How much land does a man need? Mm-hmm. And this was the time where those sadistic czars were there. And these czars, wanted to play a game. And this man came and said, can I have some piece of land? Enough for my family to build a hut. He was a serf, those people who are landless. And the Tsar had an evil plan, and he said, as much as you run, you will get the land. Keep running. How much you can cover. So then he started a marathon. He ran, and then his heart was palpitating. He was in the cardio zone, and he ran some more. And then it came into the acute zone, and then it came into danger zone. But first he thought of his wife, then he thought of his children, then he thought of his dog and cat, then he thought of his children's children, and then he thought, if I run one more, I will finish seven generations. And then what happened? He dropped dead. Instant heart attack, you know. And then the Tsar clapped his hands, called the undertakers, asked them to measure the body. 6 foot 2 inches is what the land he got. This is what it is. So, you see, this whole running for which one does is very unbecoming. And so the doing is not going to help me understand this. What is going to help is to dispel the need for the running in the first place. That's this knowledge. Yeah. Yeah, wonderful. Nice to see you. And then I will see you tomorrow. Nipun is from Mumbai. Oh.